So, you know, Barbara, I'm going to ask if we could just pause for 1 second till we
Sure.
get all of the, because of our public meeting requirements,
Sure, sorry.
want to make sure that we open our meeting, and then I'll start looking for the form.
Okay.
Why don't I do that? And then we can start the discussion. So, good morning, everyone. Everyone's here, Melia?
Everyone in the waiting room is here. We don't have quorum, but as long as we don't take any votes, we're okay.
Okay. Thank you, Melia. So good morning, everyone.
Good
My name is
morning.
Barbara Cass. I am the senior advisor to the commissioner at DPH for long-term care. And this is the April meeting for the Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment Advisory Council. I did write myself a few notes that I would mention in the introductory comments. And the most important thing that I wanted to remind people that we do have an established website. Our agendas and our meeting minutes are posted with the recording on the website. I'm going to stop for a moment and give any public members the opportunity for comment. And hearing none, I will move on to a approval for the February 6th 2024 minutes. We didn't approve those last meeting. And as part of our public meeting requirements, we do need to approve those.
Motion to approve.
Thank you, Dr. Beyer.
Second.
And thank you, Dr. Sussman. So, Barbara, I will turn it over to you while I pull up the form. Good morning, Carl.
My call. Okay, so we're going to run through some of the suggestions for revision of the MOST form. And I'm going to start right from the top if that's okay with everybody. And please stop me if I missed one of your suggestions. But starting at the beginning, I think everyone agreed we need the name. There was concern about whether we needed the address. So could people, I think it's fine, but I'm really not going to die on a hill over this one. So any comments? Anybody on this panel here want to delete the address? No, so it stays.
Actually, Barbara, can I pause there? I receive a comment, and I think we should stop for a moment just to talk about the address because there are some individuals that do experience housing insecurity. So,
So we can record that, right?
would we record their address then as a 22 Main Street house of, I'm making this up, House of Bread homeless shelter?
Yeah, I think we should leave it to the people filling out the form. I think they can figure out what a great way to put that is. We do it in all our records at the hospital, so
Okay. So
I wouldn't dictate
organizations,
how to do that, I guess is
okay.
what I'm saying.
So organizations do have a process in place for individuals that do have some insecurity around housing.
Yes.
Okay. Wanted to represent a comment that has been presented so that we're looking at a broad spectrum of the issues that have come up.
Posing a question then, is the form considered valid if an address is missing?
Think so.
We do not indicate, we've deleted that error, that comment or that declaration that if any elements are missing, then the form is invalid. So I'm going to write that down though, Dr. Breyer, for a question for our attorney. I think if we take out that declaration that if you do not complete this form in its entirety, it is invalid. Taking that out, I think, negates that then, but let me check.
The follow-up question to that too is if an address that's listed is has been changed. For example, someone who has become progressively more frail no longer lives at home and is now residing at a facility with a little bit more resource support. Is that does that somehow invalidate the address if it's not up to date?
I will clarify that. Thank you.
And I guess another clarifying question, what is the purpose of having the address? Does it add value to this form?
I think, you know, a lot of the original entries into the form were hopefully for future research. So we could even get locations of cities and towns where we're using this and that kind of thing. So I don't see a burden to it. If we were looking at a benefit burden analysis of it here.
Mouse up, Tim. Go to sleep. Sorry I'm late. I wondered about making it optional. And then if it's complicated, they can not do it if it's more for research.
I think the more identifiers you have on this form, the better. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping you all saw the recent lawsuit that just was filed with the DNR order being wrong on a patient. I think it happened at the reservoir. So, you know, I think the identifiers are helpful to those who are executing these orders. Mm-hmm. Be sure they've got the right patient.
And I might add that I agree with you, Barbara, which brings into question why we would, especially with that lawsuit, why would we not want to make sure that every section is completed? But if you've already made that decision, I'm okay with it. But I just think just to make sure that to cover all of our bases, to make this a legal document, to make this executable, that every piece of it should be completed.
I mean, optional is fine too. I mean, I think we have to, we've got 10 minutes, so we've already spent a lot on just the first one.
Wake up, mouse down 10.
Jim, I see your brain working.
Mouse click.
You're muted, Jim, you're muted.
There. Well, I agree having an optional, putting in parentheses optional so that you're not excluding somebody who doesn't have an address or doesn't want to give their address or who has moved from one place to another, because I think that is a reality that a lot of folks in these circumstances are facing. They may well have to move. And you don't want the form to suddenly be interpreted as invalid because their address changed, but the form reflects an older address. So.
Thanks, Jim. So we have a suggestion to put optional, and we have two positive responses to that. So shall we go with it? Yes. Thank you all very much. The second one is the diagnosis. And I know there was some concern whether that needed to be put there because you may have more than one and a number of different reasons. And Kathy, you had a comment about that in your email. Kathy, you're mute.
Muted.
There you go.
Sorry, it takes me a little longer.
Oh, fine.
The reason for the diagnosis is as a qualifying factor for the most. It doesn't need to list everything they have, but we need to make sure people are not putting down things like Down syndrome, cerebral palsy, because we know that's happening in Massachusetts. So, and I'll talk to that later if that ends up working out. But that's my concern, is that it really be someone that qualifies for a MOST because of a terminal illness or a life-limiting or a chronic progressive frailty.
Thank you, Kathy. Anybody else? I support leaving them there.
Yeah.
All right.
Agree.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, our big goals of treatment section. We do have to make a decision here about hospitalization or not. We've had multiple suggestions for that. I think
Can I just interrupt for 1 second? Am I sharing my screen? You
yes.
See a form? Okay. The position is different on my monitor, so I want to make sure you're seeing the MOST form.
Okay. Yes, I'll fix the CPR. I'll spell it out. Thanks, Rich. So goals of treatment.
I think you said the opposite, since it's spelled out above.
We can use CPR. Okay.
CPR, correct.
Use the acronym.
Yes.
Okay. Got it. Now, goals of treatment, we decided on the words last time, but we want to add something about hospitalization because we're deleting F, transfer to hospital. We're deleting that at the bottom of page one. So I sent you a bunch of different suggestions, and Dr. Breyer, maybe you could tell us what you thought. I think a lot of people agreed with you.
Yeah, I think I made a just pointing out that hospitalization is different than transferring to a hospital. So just wanted to kind of emphasize that distinction. But I think for patients that are full treatment, I think I actually sent maybe what the suggested what the California Pulse current format is, such that full treatment kind of implies transport to the hospital. Selective treatment is kind of where this is more of a choice and might benefit from an additional box as a subset of selective treatment. But for comfort-focused treatment, transport is not recommended unless symptoms cannot be controlled in the current location.
Okay, and I agree with you on all three. I think full treatment does not need a statement about hospitalization. That seems rather obvious. The person's going to go to the hospital if they want full treatment. Comfort focused, we can certainly add patient prefers no transfer to hospital for life. No, that was South Carolina. Do not transfer to hospital unless comfort needs cannot be met in current situation. That is sort of universal across the country. So I can add that to the third one. It's the middle one that we want to be sure we've got the words you actually want. And I'm open for suggestions for that one. One is transfer to hospital if indicated, avoid ICU if possible.
I think the avoid that language about avoiding intensive care is a little wobbly, but I don't have any suggestions.
I tend to favor the transfer to hospital only if comfort needs cannot be met in current location. The reason being is that there's a element of subjectivity in terms of comfort, and that allows clinicians to kind of...
So are you under selective treatments, Dr. Breyer?
Yes, sorry.
So you only wanted to mention comfort?
I'm
concerned about other needs not being met because people are going to be asking for additional treatments. If other treatments cannot be met at home, other conditions cannot be met at home. So could it be a little bit broader? Would you be okay with that?
Yeah, it's slightly more broad is I think reasonable in that category as well.
Okay. Transfer to hospital. All right.
Good. If requested, I guess, or.
I'm sorry?
If requested, perhaps, or if you want to leave it a little bit more vague.
Well, the thing is that selective treatments are going to be something, you know, decided by who's ever.
I'm wondering, because it says transfer to hospital if needed to treat these conditions. So that to me, that seems explanatory. I guess I'm confused as to what are we trying to do on selective treatment that's different than that?
No, what that section is saying is somebody may want to get treatment for another condition other than what they have. As Dr. Breyer said, they might fall and hurt their hip or something and they need to go get an x-ray. So in that section, we're saying transfer to hospital if treatment needs cannot be met in current location. But I don't want to limit it to just comfort needs.
Right.
No, right. So I feel like the language that's there is sufficient. It says treat all reversible medical conditions, transfer to hospital if or as needed to treat these conditions.
Well, I'm wondering
at the same form.
I
We're
agree.
Not looking at the same form.
Oh, I'm looking at the form that's on the shared screen.
Yes, I agree with Mary.
Okay.
I think that, I don't know, to me that's pretty explanatory. I don't know why we're changing.
So just leave it
the
as
original
it is,
form.
Yep, that's fine.
Now, what was the reason why we even started this discussion? It's escaping me to rewrite this.
Because we wanted to get rid of the do not transfer to hospital versus do transfer to hospital. And we wanted to integrate that thought into these goals.
Right.
So is it okay the way it is?
I like it.
That's
okay.
What I'm hearing, Barbara.
All right. Don't forget to send this to me then. Please.
I'm going to send it to you right now.
All right. Is there anything else? I mean, those were the... Just go to the second page, maybe, Barbara?
Yeah, let me just... it's gone.
We just have to wait to hear about the witness that's still on there.
Yes. And then... I just have some grammatical corrections in these two boxes here. Completing
okay.
MOLST and using MOLST.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Barbara.
Oh, you're welcome.
So before we move on to the last part of this, we have consensus for, not, we're not taking a vote, Malia, so we're good, but we have consensus on everything that we've discussed so far. Here's where it's important to note that this form does not need to be in perpetuity. We can go back and revisit this form. And one thing that I would suggest that we do is ask a few of the providers that are in our group if they would be willing to, and I'm using my words carefully, trial, not pilot, because a pilot might imply some legislation, but trial the form and use it at the same time that you're using the existing form and work out any challenges that way. And perhaps come back to us at the next meeting and say, I've worked this and it's meeting all of our needs. Does that sound reasonable and fair?
Yes.
So thank you.
To that end, is there anyone who would be open to taking it and putting it in a practical setting, using the current approved form and working this form alongside that?
I'd be happy to. I see patients 1 week a month, so it might take some time to ensure that I have a patient that's appropriate, but I'd be happy to do that.
And that'll work out well, Dr. Sussman, because that'll get us to the end of session, and we'll have a definitive answer about our proposal to remove the witness signature. So that would be, I think, very reasonable.
I'd be happy to circulate it amongst EMS, paramedics, and EMTs. However, I think that might be a little bit different of a format. It would probably be good to have like mock versions filled in and see what they would do with it and how they would interpret it, since they're not responsible for completing it, and see if that confuses them in any way. I don't know if someone would be interested in actually, I'm happy to kind of, you know, fill one out in a version, but if someone else would like to, I'm happy to kind of circulate it amongst different EMS clinicians.
I think that sounds very reasonable, Dr. Breyer, and perhaps we can ask Dr. Kamen as well to bring this to his EMS advisory council and the EMS advisory board. The advisory board is a representation of the medical directors, EMS medical directors in the state. So I think it would be very helpful to at least get their perspective, because they will be the first one looking at this form in many situations. And we want to make sure it's clear to them as well. Discussion on that? Any position? Does anyone think that that is, there's no utility in that? Okay. So then completing the MOLST and using the MOLST. Now with
Barbara, can you just go back to goals of treatment for a minute?
Of course.
On this particular form, on the one you're showing us?
This may be an older form, Barbara, that I was struggling to find the most current.
Oh,
form.
Okay, because so I do not remember all that in, we don't have selective treatments goal restore function. That doesn't make sense. What we had was treat all potentially reversible medical conditions with symptoms.
So you're saying this was out right here?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll fix it. Yeah, I'll fix it.
Okay.
Because it's only selective. If you're going to restore function, then it's not going to everything. It's not going to be selective. Okay, I'll fix it.
Okay. And then. Right here, if you could just look at that, Barbara, it doesn't read right to me.
Oh, it's just got an extra do in it.
It's got an extra do.
Yes.
Okay.
And then I also... So this was... maybe I'm reading into this way too much, who have the potential to live with the assistance of life-supporting interventions.
Mm-hmm.
Is it who choose to live? I don't know if we are the ones who should be making a judgment that they have the potential to live, but individuals have the right to choose how they live. I'm trying to represent person-centeredness here. And decision making, and I may have overanalyzed it, but
no, I think you're right.
I think that's a good observation, and I would agree with choose to live.
And then over on this side, I would just propose that we. Juxtapose number 6, which says most are actionable medical orders, as the first one. Perhaps it's just so that the reader knows that these are medical orders. These are unlike advanced care planning decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
And then it feeds into... what is currently number one, these orders are affected immediately. That's all sort of the same concept.
I don't know if the word actionable is required. I think most are medical orders is probably sufficient.
Mm-hmm. 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 And then my other last comment or edit is in number 2, we need to qualify that appointments and or admissions for healthcare facilities. Perhaps not. I'm wordsmithing at this point, probably. And it's difficult for me to bring the whole thing up so that.
Right. Yeah.
Because we're.
That would just clarify it a little bit, but.
Or maybe hospital visits instead of admissions, getting back to Dr. Pryor's point, the emergency department might not be an admission.
Right. You're quite right. 3 days in observation or something.
So what should it say, please? Medical appointments and or
admissions. Hospital visits.
I was also thinking when I suggested healthcare facilities that there is utility for an individual who may need a visit to a nursing home.
Yep.
For whatever reason. Or maybe for their an extended stay.
Or when they go off to PT.
Correct. So I wasn't actually thinking limiting it to hospitals, but we want to bring
Barbara, yes. Healthcare facilities. I think that's a nice comprehensive term.
Got it, guys. Thank you.
Those are the end of my comments. I'm going to stop sharing. I'm afraid to say it. Are we done? I applaud you all if we are. Okay.
I think we're done. But I also think, you know, it is important to hear what the EMS world reacts to, you know, a couple of drafts, yeah, because it's really that in many cases, they will be the first people to encounter this form. So that would be important. So we may have to revisit it after we hear their comments. And then I don't know, your next step is to what? Move it on to the commissioner for review or something?
That would be our next step at DPH, to give the commissioner visibility on the form, yes. And her opportunity to comment if there's anything that's compelling to her, yes.
Is there a legal review before that?
We will, good question, Carl, good comment.
Yes.
I'm assuming that would be part of it.
But... Yes, we have legal review of all kinds of forms. And I think we'd also need to change the policies and procedures before we implement this because they would be inconsistent, which is a separate process.
Thank you, Attorney Costa. Okay. I think we're done. So Barbara, next steps then. You will, thank you for all your work on this. Very grateful. This has been a very heavy lift. We will wait on the final revisions. I will see if there's someone at DPH who could help us format it so that it falls into place nicely. And again, trying to keep it at the double-sided form. And then we will, Dr. Sussman, thank you. I'm wondering if Jonathan Weber, does Jonathan Weber see patients as well? I know Jonathan has an administrative role also at Yale.
I believe he does.
But perhaps Jonathan could trial it as well. I will give it to Dr. Kamen for him to bring to his next advisory council and advisory board meetings for their feedback. And then hopefully we can get this moving. And by the end of session, we will have a decision either way about House Bill 5290, and we will be able to move forward. The other two issues, actually one outstanding issue on this is, and maybe food for thought for our next meeting, do we want to limit it to a lime green form? Or am I putting the horse before the cart now, or the cart before the horse, and let's get the form trialed, and then we'll make those decisions about a lime green form and exploring electronic versions of this.
I'm certainly eager to remove any barriers to using the form, but acknowledge there's history, and I don't want to slow things down. So if people think it will move forward more quickly as the lime green form, I'm not opposed to that, but certainly eager to explore, again, ways that we can reduce barriers to using the form as widely as possible.
I agree with Dr. Sussman, and if that could be pursued in parallel, that would be great.
Please go ahead, Jim.
The people who wanted some kind of distinctive identifier that was pretty obvious were from the EMS world. Now, whether it be lime green form or a border as, you know, something that makes it stand out so they could recognize it more easily and train staff to it. But that's, once again, I think, dependent on the feedback we get from the EMS people on that.
I think the color is probably preferred, but maybe not totally necessary if it would limit the wide distribution, as same with kind of electronic versions and forms.
Right. See how important they think it is.
Okay.
I think that the the different versions are for different people, because honestly, if it's electronic, there are going to be, you know, when someone's admitted, or if it's a direct admit or whatever, there's a whole group of people that are relying on the electronic version. And certainly the people who are arriving at home, you know, maybe that's that lime green, but honestly, I think that we need to pursue things concurrently, because I just think different people access the form differently. And so we don't need to focus on preserving the color for one group of people if there's a whole other group of people that are going to be using it a different way.
The thing is that regarding the EMS, what I envision is the EMS on the way to the home with a tablet looking up the form. And I think that is the best case scenario.
So Dr. Breyer is an ED physician. Is that something that is helpful in the handoff from EMS to the emergency department side of this, if all of that is done before the transition to care? EMS is explored electronically and or they have a hard copy.
For sure. So I'm both an EMS and an ED physician. So from both perspectives, I think I've encountered scenarios where family is unable to produce the paper form, and they do have a photo of it electronically, and EMS was not allowed to honor that because it was a not electronic version. However, as a emergency medicine physician, you know, I think it can, we have the ability to kind of, you know, be a little bit more reasonable about intent in these scenarios and discuss with family. But EMS clinicians do not always have that ability since they're very protocolized. And then in terms of the question of as an ED physician, I would take certainly any form that EMS brings, whether that be electronic or paper, I would certainly take into consideration in terms of making decisions about interventions.
So I don't want to belabor this too much, because I think once we have a final product, we can explore this more. But I think we should be looking at this in parallel to getting the form finally approved and moving in. What I'm hearing from this group is that there is an openness to do an electronic form.
Yeah, I think it's inevitable, and it's probably, what I want to repeat, as I've said in earlier meetings, is that there have to be some safeguards around that, so that someone who has who wants to change their mind about some provision of that has some instructions as to how they go about that. Uh-huh. Because if they don't have direct access to their own electronic medical records, they can't really do that. So that's one issue. And then the other is, I'm not sure the extent to which people operating in the field, you know, Rebecca's idea of having a tablet as you're racing to the scene in response to a 911 call is great, but I don't know that the system supports that yet. So
there's two people in the car, one's driving and the other one's
I understand that. It's just that the sometimes the paramed's driving alone, but it's also I just don't know that the system is that sophisticated to support that kind of up-to-date information yet throughout Connecticut. That's all. It's not, I don't know what the system capabilities are.
So I think that is something that is growing a lot now. And we even have the ability to actually do pre-notifications from the EMS perspective. So if an EKG is done in the field and a patient has a heart attack, you can actually notify the hospital in advance with like a push notification. And very much there's a lot of electronic access that EMS can actually, it's growing. Certainly right. there's room for improvement in a lot of this. I do want to make a distinction though between having an electronic MULST registry, which is different than the allowing of electronic versions of the pulsed, which is different than having allowing photo versions of it. Part of the thought being is if you can fill out the form electronically, much the same way before surgery, sometimes you might have a consent form and do an electronic signature. All of the data that's there can be kind of pre-filled, and inversion control, as Jim was alluding to, is actually improved because it's therefore kind of the most recent version is actually more likely to be available. It gets a little bit more complicated, I think, when it's just electronic versions that are PDFs or photos, because they don't necessarily link to the system in the same way, and they're not queryable or searchable. So wanted to provide that additional bit of context.
I was wondering about EMS having access to something like MyChart for the patient. And if that were stored in MyChart, they would be able to access it there, which is kind of a shortcut to a repository.
Yeah, unfortunately, EMS does not have access to MyChart. I know there is an effort from this on the state side, and perhaps someone else probably more informed can speak to it, to improve health information exchange, though, with EMS in general, separately. And this would be, I think MULST would be certainly, should be a prominent part of that, since portability is so important for this document.
Thank you. Any other discussion before we move on to our next agenda item? Just next steps in terms of the electronic piece. I will see what I can do at this end. And maybe I can connect with Dr. Kamen. And Dr. Breyer, I'm sure you have just as much awareness as Dr. Kamen, but perhaps what could facilitate or what the mechanism for that would be at the EMS level to access an electronic form, and also the integration into the electronic health record. That may be an organizational issue that needs to be worked out at perhaps the Yale, Harvard Healthcare, the system level. And I don't know, Carl, if you have any insight with your membership, and maybe this is a separate conversation that we could have regarding how that would be actualized.
Yeah, that's a separate conversation.
Okay. Okay. So why don't we move on then? Kathy is next on the agenda, and she's going to discuss her interactions that she's had with Massachusetts MULST. Kathy, are there any documents that you could send me that I could share that is helpful, or are you comfortable with just speaking?
Well, I think for now, I'm just going to present it. It's just in an outline form, okay. And if people want a copy of it later, I can send it along. I can make it prettier. It's just, right now, it's just notes. Okay. But I'm hoping that what I share will be helpful as we go forward. Because I know there is, well, I'll just start. But thank you. And let me do one thing so it doesn't mute by accident. Wake up, mouse 7-4, mouse click, go to sleep. All right, well, thank you. So some of you who have been on board with this all the way from the beginning, we'll remember that in Connecticut, disability rights advocates got involved with MULST because we had a lot of misgivings about it in the beginning. And specifically, two of those were the confusion that a lot of medical providers have between chronic disability and terminal illness. You wouldn't think those would get mixed up, but they frequently did and do. And the other concern we had was about medical practitioners who have a lot of expertise and credibility, possibly steering people away from life-sustaining treatments that could be beneficial and buy us a lot of years. So thanks to you, those of you who have been in on it from the beginning, we have created Connecticut as a model of a disability-friendly MOST. So thank you for that. And I understand while consistency with other states is a desirable goal, I don't want us to lose what we've got. Bear with me a second. Sorry. Not a great breathing day for me today, but we're going to keep going. So, in another role in my life, I work with doctors and nurses in Massachusetts. And at one of our recent meetings, MOST came up, and not particularly favorably. So I met with two of the nurses from our group, and here is what they shared with us. Now, keep in mind, they work mostly with people with intellectual disabilities. So guardianship questions come up frequently. In Massachusetts, it is required to go through the court to expand guardianship if you're going to make any kind of end-of-life decision. The current practice for a DNR or a MOST is to do it in conjunction with an expanded guardianship and the consensus of the group that is around that individual. So family and providers that work closely with that person and understand them the best. Unfortunately, this safeguard of expanded guardianship is now going through the court for that. It's now being bypassed frequently. And the word that nurse used was that this is alarming. In order to empower a guardian to make the end-of-life decisions, it's required that a physician write a medical certificate and a medical affidavit. And that sounds good, and that's supposed to be a protection. But these days, too often, these certificates and affidavits are using information about disability or features of disability as the justification for the MOST, or for the expanded guardianship request. Physicians are actually writing things like, this person is wheelchair bound and cannot speak. This person cannot leave the house without exceptional effort from others. This person cannot provide self-care. And one that's really popular with them is, this person has been ill for many years. Furthermore, if one of the issues is dysphagia, the conclusion of the affidavit is often that the person should not be at risk of future aspiration pneumonia and should be allowed a more dignified death with less pain. Personally, for me, as someone who has added 27 years to my life by having a feeding tube, I find that one especially tragic. The expanded guardianship process can be compromised when the hospital believes that the guardian is actually a healthcare proxy, which is a more powerful role, as I understand it. This bypasses the need for guardianship expansion through the court, because the hospital just writes HCP, healthcare proxy, when they are actually talking with the guardian. This not only bypasses the court system, but it also bypasses DDS, because the guardian and the hospital are just talking directly with each other and not involving DDS staff, or local service providers who might be able to present the person's baseline. You know, people will say things like, well, they won't walk, or they won't talk. It's like, yeah, and they weren't walking or talking before, so this is not a terrible thing for those of us who already have those situations. So there's a lot of things there that need attention and are troublesome. Bear with me, I've got a little bit more. Okay, so the other things that also need to be considered is, it's turning out that many people in Massachusetts who already have disabilities, especially acquired brain injury, are actually using DNR, DNI, and MOST as a way of saying they don't want to be treated again because they've been through a really traumatic experience. For example, this often occurs when someone has been involved with substance abuse and they've attempted to end their life and it didn't go the way they thought. So now they had all this pain and all these difficulties before getting their disability. And now they've had things done to them that weren't necessarily pleasant. And now they're living in a situation that is even more challenging. And they're just like, we're done. This is not what I was in for. So they're using MOST for that. And that's kind of troubling to the people around them who are providing support and trying to help them live a good life. But of course, you know, it's in their choice. But I think the critical point of all of that is they're not terminally ill. They're disabled. So maybe a DNR, but not a MOST, because that's not what a MOST is intended to do. Or they could use an advanced directive too, but it's not actionable in the moment the way a MOST is. So that's a really complicated, difficult one. And then there's a couple more here. That in Massachusetts, Medicare licensing requires that every nursing home have the end-of-life discussion with the resident. And that's good. That's not a bad idea to do. But what that's being interpreted as and implemented as is that every resident must have a most. It's not what it says. It's saying everyone should have the end of life discussion. The other thing you need to know is that in Massachusetts, the most does not have a do everything option, as ours does. If you want full treatment, you have to write it in the form, in between the lines of it. The other thing is, with our whole discussion of hospitalize or do not hospitalize or do not transfer to hospital, there's concerns among these nurses with the Massachusetts most that it does say have an option for do not hospitalize. And then there could be anaphylaxis or internal bleeding, or somebody could fall, which should bring someone to the hospital. So there are all these problematic things with it. And then finally, and this is not a most thing, but I thought it was an interesting comment from the nurse, that too often nowadays, we used to just hear DNR, but now so often we're hearing DNR and DNI. And she was saying these should not be linked together because there might be an accident or an incident where intubation would be appropriate and beneficial to the person, even though CPR might not. So those are things that she would like to see separated because they're different issues. So this is what I gathered in my interview with them. I will attempt to answer any questions, although I'm not a nurse and I'm not an attorney, but I think all of these things indicate that we've done really well in Connecticut. We need to hold on to the good things we've got here. So thank you for your time.
Kathy, thank you for that presentation and the summary of your interactions regarding Massachusetts. And I think it's critically important for us to pause for a moment on your comments and your thoughts, because there is work that's being discussed about portability of MOLST, POLST, COLST, whatever the state term may be. And with that portability, the impact that those interpretations in Massachusetts may have to our Connecticut residents. Mm-hmm. So I think important discussion for us to have at some point. And again, how we approach that portability, especially with our border states, with New York, you know, states that do touch us.
Thank you, Barbara. And I have been saying for years, and I'm partly tongue-in-cheek, but partly completely serious as well, I agree that there should be portability because people go back and forth to different places. Mm-hmm. And not just border states. People go to Florida, people go to California, mm-hmm. Arizona. I get it. And I have always said, yeah, I believe in that idea. I think the entire country should adopt ours. I know that's not likely, but I'm going to keep saying it because I really think we have the best one in the country. Thanks to you all and all the predecessors for 10 years who've been trying to make this a really good and safe and effective and appropriate tool. So I don't know how we do that, but I'm going to keep saying it because it's really what I believe.
I just wanted to say thank you, Kathy, for for all of that, for all that you've done so far. And yeah, that context, I think that's tremendously helpful and admirable. And I just appreciate your advocacy you're sharing both your personal experience as well as those that you've had in Massachusetts is just it provides a lot of helpful context and just thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pryor.
Any other discussion, comments, thoughts? Barbara? Well,
yeah, oh, Kathy.
Sorry, I didn't see your hand up.
That's okay.
In the corner, thank you.
Kathy, again, you enrich our understanding of these issues, and I certainly do appreciate that. Can I just focus on the expanded guardianship issue?
Mm-hmm.
Where in our document, either the form or the standard operating procedures, do we discuss the DSS process? Does anyone know?
Yeah, it's actually in the statute itself.
Okay.
And what it says is that nothing in this section reduces the authority of the Commissioner of Developmental Services to exercise the responsibilities he has under his statute. And that those responsibilities are essentially to review the circumstances surrounding a proposed do not resuscitate order for anyone who is under his care and treatment.
But does that include a most, Jim?
Well, that's a good question.
Okay.
Because certainly there's parts of MULS that does, but on the other hand, their health services director, the former one, the one who just retired, interpreted it to not include the MULS. But I don't know if she checked with their counsel on it or whatever. And I was, and then she retired before I had a chance to really, get into it with her. So it was
because I was doing a MULS with a team of people, actually, for a patient who did have approaching the end of life, who did have a guardian, and DSS was major league involved.
Yes,
because the patient was sent home with an appropriate MULS document, and they were very much involved and wanted that. Kathy mentioned that physician evaluation and how all those horrible things get written on that form. And I've seen that a million times. So I'm just wondering if when we do our operating procedures, we might spend a little time about addressing that in those.
Right. I think that it's, people from the service world who work extensively with individuals who have significant disabilities, intellectual and developmental disabilities, very often know kind of the support options that can help that person to live a happy and successful life.
Right.
Whereas people who aren't from that world, it all seems like just strange and, it's kind of, so it's part of its education too. But I agree, having there's a whole discussion that's happened in the area of intellectual and developmental disabilities about different models for guardianship. And one of them that has sort of had it's on the ascendancy is having a team of people serve as a guardian as opposed to a given individual. Now we're a long way from getting a statute that recognizes that, at least here in Connecticut, because very often it's a transfer of parental rights to, when the individual reaches the age of majority, their parents sort of apply for guardianship and it's sort of automatically granted. And that's, but then there's limited guardians and there's plenary guardians. There's limited guardians for medical decisions. There's a whole lot of options in the Connecticut General Statutes for guardianship. And then there's also conservatorship, which is something that applies usually to people who are not intellectually and or developmentally disabled. So, the term guardianship is also used for minors. So there's different, you have to be clear about which guardian you're to, which type of guardian you're talking about, and look at specifically what is their authority. In some cases, the limited guardian for medical for healthcare decisions is supposed to, that's supposed to be limited to routine medical treatment, consent for routine medical treatment, which means that anything extraordinary, they're supposed to go back to the probate court and say, these are the facts confronting us. Do I have the authority to consent to this or that particular procedure? And there are some specific prohibitions about that. Not allowed to consent to an abortion, not allowed to psychosurgery. You can't, consent to that. So those are, there's a lot to it. There's a, it's a very complicated thing.
So Kathy and Jim, do you think we're good for now with the issue of guardianship?
I think so. I think it just, to me, this is a cautionary tale about how any good reform has within it the seeds of its own perversion, because it sounds to me like what's happening is that in spite of the safeguards that were established in Massachusetts, they're being disregarded and or misunderstood and disregarded. So that's something to be watching for, I think.
So thank you all. We are a little bit over, but I do want to report off one thing. Carl, thank you for the addition of an update on 5290. I did put a link to the House bill in the agenda. And the update really at DPH is not as exciting as I would like to be able to convey, but we are continuing to work with any gaps or information sharing that there may, and I know I'm sounding cryptic, or information sharing that may surround what needs to be done, but we continue to support that. And we are doing our work at DPH to foster the, hopefully, any deficits or gaps or challenges that there may be in terms of knowledge or awareness around that. And I will leave the training for next month, unless we have any other things that we need to finish up with the form. I think that is started its journey to get progressively better. So thank you all. Great meeting. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, everybody. Bye.